So without further ado, let me first invite Mr. Ravi Shankar Prasad to respond to the central theme, connecting South Asia and connecting its people.
Well, if I can begin with the case of India, there is a fundamental philosophy underlying our approach to digital connect. We missed the Industrial Revolution because of various historical reasons. We missed the Entrepreneur Revolution, which swept the world, different parts, in 50s, 60s, 70s, and 80s, because of the license permit quota raj, which we had in our country. We don't want to miss the digital revolution. We want to become leaders in that. That's the first philosophy behind it. And the second is, digital connect designed to empower India to have a better life, plain and simple. The second, digital governance is good governance, is transparent governance. Very briefly, what is the digital ecosystem of India? Number one, we have 1.03 billion mobile phones in India. We have 1.05 billion Aadhaar card, digital identity. And 400 million internet, 60% mobile based, very soon likely to become 500 million. I need to compliment Indian mobile sector who have done very well. Okay. A silent revolution has happened in India. What we are doing is very clear, let me tell you very briefly. Samir, we are creating infrastructure, connecting 250,000 gram panchayats by optical fiber network. Number two, unleashing a big revolution of common service centers at the hinterland, nearly 250,000, giving digital services, making Aadhaar card, passport, banking, insurance. This great initiative of postal payment bank in 650 districts of India, whereby our rural postman will go with a handheld device to deliver services in the ground. And lastly, pro-people initiative through digital services. E-hospital, about 40 hospitals are connected for registration of patients through digital connect. E-scholarship, about 10 million students are on portal of e-scholarship. Then the great program of digital inclusion, Jan Dhan Yojana. We opened 240 million accounts in a short span of 1 year. Connected that with Aadhaar, verifiable digital identity, seeded to the bank. And we have saved close to $6 billion in various pro-people initiatives. Today, nearly 31 states of India are having their land record digitized. The digital ecosystem of the country has come on autopilot. Okay. And as I always say, digital India is more for the poor, for the underprivileged. A more inclusive society. And obviously, once India rises, and one thing I must mention, Samir, apart from digital India, make in India, skill India, startup India, stand-up India, we are also pushing manufacturing in a big way. And I'm with this August audience, I'm happy to share, in the last 1 year, 40 mobile manufacturing units have come in India, which is hardly one or two when our government had come to power. And it is creating ripples all around. India is becoming a big center of mobile manufacturing. India is home today to 270 million smartphones. So from manufacturing to services to infrastructure to governance, all are working together, cloud, your digital locker. We started digital locker only 6 months ago. I'm happy to tell you that today nearly 2 million people have come on board. And nearly almost 4 million plus government records are on digital locker. All the new technology from manufacturing and then Internet of Things and other things. I always say, as far as Asia's journey is concerned, in which I include India, I include other parts of Asia, China, the journey from the desktop to the laptop to the smartphone, which is a mini computer, is a phenomenal journey, game changer. And I think Asia, in terms of creating a digitally inclusive world, is going to play a very crucial role.
So let me ask you one question, because I think that's something that everyone has been praising this government for, but there have also been some degree of skepticism. The government itself seems to have become a startup. It's engaged in so many businesses and activities that are normally the preserve and domain of the private sector. Are we creating also the ecosystem where we can promote entrepreneurship and small and the SMEs in the digital and in the technology sectors to thrive?
Some degree of government leverage is important to promote initiative, I always feel. And therefore the startup movement, the kind of electronic fund, development fund, or the startup development fund, all the government can create. The initial ecosystem, Sunil, you will talk to Sunil when he will join you after me, and surely he will have to a lot to explain how he became an entrepreneur. There was some government initiative needed. And today he has become a giant of the world. I compliment him, as many have become too. But some initial leveraging is important for the government. This whole mobile manufacturing, how it picked up, electronic manufacturing, medical electronics, defense electronics, auto electronics, because of the incentives we gave. Therefore, to say, I'm not saying government should remain in the business, but the government must remain the facilitator. And how I see the role of the government, Samir, the government initially as an administrator, the government thereafter became the administrator come regulator. Now the government's role in India should be administrator come facilitator. That's how I see it.
So since the theme this afternoon is connected South Asia, are there real possibilities of creating a common e-market? You know, there has been a proposal in the TPP arrangements about joining up countries and their digital economies. Is there a possibility, and is it now the time to explore connecting this region, at least on the cloud?
I have only one problem. I'm all for it. And I'm very proud of Indian IT companies, present in 200 cities of 80 countries. The export of our IT this year has been $108 billion, the highest ever. They're the biggest recipient of FDI, almost sharing 9% of the GDP. But my only problem is that if India starts doing well, then we see barriers. Okay, I don't want to elaborate it. I hope you understand what I'm trying to hint at. Now, if the same thing starts happening as in E also, then that is a problem. There, if the world is open, it must be genuinely open. And talking Indian Economic Summit, I always say, Indian companies go abroad, they pay good tax, they create good employment. I think they are contributing substantially to the GDP of foreign countries also. The same in Indian mobile companies going abroad in any part of the world, they are doing a good job. Therefore, digital connect in commerce is a natural corollary. Okay. But if the connect is good, the initiative needs to be respected. That's how I see it.
So you come from a state that is requires a huge degree of transformation. You represent Bihar. I would like to ask you, since in New Delhi the new buzzword is cashless transactions, cash-light societies, how is the uptake in the peri-urban and rural India to these new opportunities of digital payments, of using technology for small trade and small commerce?
Let me ask you a question. I think Sharma will be the best person to answer you. When his turn will come, you'll ask him. But he's doing a good job. Why not? This digital payment in India is picking up very fast. Okay, it is not only on TV screens, I am seeing it. One study needs to be done. How many of Indians are using digital devices for in the farming sector? That will be a classic study. The e-mandi which we have started, because my NIC remains involved in creation of all this, it is doing quite well. This e-passport, e-visa. Therefore, this whole acceptance of digital technology to ensure a hassle-free existence is the real enabler. And I would feel as India is changing, because if Jandhan is the classic account, if without any middleman or fictitious account, my money is coming in my account, that is a recognition of respect for digital connect, and digital payment flows from there. And always remember, Jandhan is the account, bank account of those who had no bank accounts. That means poor people on the margins. And it only reinforces my premise, digital India, more for the poor, more for the underprivileged.
Before I invite a couple of questions from the audience, because we will have to let you go in 5 minutes, my final question to you would be, how do you see the digital economy contributing to job creation, or are we going to see technology create disruptions in the workforce?
Well, this is a very debatable question. I see Indian digital economy crossing $1 trillion in the coming 4 to 5 years. Once the digital India becomes completely proactive as it is, you talked of my estate. I had a lurking apprehension, Aadhaar may not be employed there, but they are realizing the worth of Aadhaar and they are becoming proactive. The northeastern states, I traveled in the entire country, there is a keenness to adopt Aadhaar. And mind you, we have passed a law of the parliament creating Aadhaar platform, which is completely secure, confidential as far as data is concerned. But having said that, what is more important is that there will be competition, yes, but the power of the people's interest will drive it. As Samir, I always say, and let me repeat again, Indians first love technology. No, first observe technology. Then they adopt it. Then they start loving it. And then they become empowered in the process. I thought it was an Indian phenomena, but I'm happy to say it is emerging as an Asian phenomena.
Excellent. So we'll invite a couple of questions from, please introduce yourself and do ask your question, keep it brief. And we have a lady at the back and the gentleman here. And okay, maybe one more. So we'll take three. Okay, we'll take three. Thanks.
Go ahead. Good afternoon, sir. My name is Utkarsh. My question to you is that you're the only minister in the world who's the minister of IT and law. So with cyber crime lurching around, how does this put you in a unique vantage point?
On a point of clarification to you, I am the third time the law minister of India. Okay? Therefore, that should... The prime minister chose to give me that portfolio, but yes, cyber security is important. And as our prime minister says, cyber security is akin to bloodless war. And all the civil society, democratic countries need to come together. In terms of creation of human resource, our government is very keen for that. We are creating human resource for training of judges, of police officers, of civil servants. We are creating a proper technological barriers against these. But what is important, we need to work together. And the problem is, Samir, those who flout the digital norms to create cyber security challenges are smarter than us. I always say that. The whole world has to work together. There is one brief issue must I very briefly highlight here, and that is appropriate forum. A right to access of internet must be available without discrimination. Internet is one of the finest creations of human mind. If it is a truly global platform, it must have linkage with the local. This I always feel. And this position of India I have articulated in the parliament, and this position is very important to be appreciated. Yes.
So I think what Utkarsh did not complete in his question was that we look forward to a propositional framework around encryption, privacy, and some other matters that the online management does require.
My take is very simple. There is a robust IT provision in place. If something more is needed, I am quite open to. But with one caveat, Narendra Modi government fully respect freedom of expression on the social media. And the giant movement emerging on social media is creating accountability, information, and everything.
Thank you. The lady at the back, please.
Good afternoon. I'm Sugandha, and I belong to the state of Bihar. So, and I'm a global shaper representing IRRI, International Rice Research Institute. A quick question. When is the digital world is going to the farmers sitting at the last periphery of my state? I've been working in the state for the last 4 years. And believe me, everyone, gentlemen sitting here and gentle and respected women, it is creating a miracle. Aadhaar card, DBT, lot of corruptions are getting solved because I work at the Southeast Asia level, but I have stationed myself in Bihar. I'm really looking for the day when the digitalization go to the last women and the men sitting, you know, on their farm.
Well, let me put it like this. Sunil is sitting here, therefore I need to remind you, yes, our state is backward, but Sunil's Airtel is budging in the corner of Bihar, okay? Therefore, powered by the smartphone, and I hope he'll be liberal in our state, along with all his competitors too, okay? This will create the enabling atmosphere, number one. Number two, the state government needs to be more proactive. And as I always say, digital India is ideology neutral. Digital India is politics neutral. Digital India is central state neutral. That's how we have to work.
The final question from the lady there.
The gentleman from Broadland.
Okay, I'll also. So we'll take one more.
Good afternoon. My question is, when is digital India going to become inclusive for women? What are your views on gender parity? We see men dominate computer sciences, engineering, mathematics. Are there any initiatives that the government is taking on gender parity?
Well, as far as gender parity is concerned, I will see it as a supplemental component of gender justice. Gender justice flows from our fundamental right of the Constitution, dignity, discrimination on the ground of sex. What is important is we need to work more, and I quite see your point. If India has women as a prime minister, India has women as a president, India has so many chief ministers that are women, we have got the largest number of women in our council of ministers. We need to promote more women technologists. I hope Sunil is listening to what you are saying, and we have to work together as well to make it a success. That suggestion is quite welcome. But let me tell you, in the IT sector, when I see all over the country, let us salute Indian IT sector. They have created 1 million direct job and about 3 million indirect job. And the largest employment of women is being given in the IT sector. So those are silver lining we need to recognize.
The final question, you wanted a gentleman to, was someone, yeah there, please sir.
My name is Dr. Reitz. I'm an academic expert. I congratulate your pronouncements on the political neutrality of the internet. But just the other day, I saw a news item that somebody was persecuted for posting a critical message on WhatsApp regarding Prime Minister Modi. And I'm not sure if I saw similar messages repeatedly. Is this a contradiction between local implementation and federal policies?
I don't know which newspaper you saw, but my Prime Minister has been criticized not only in India but globally, not only for the last 2 years but the last 14 years. There was an international campaign against him, yet the people stood by him. Mr. Modi has been one of the biggest supporters of social media, not from today but from mid-90s, and he's ensured that all his ministers take complaints on social media and all. You know, maybe at some cases there may be an overzealous police action. And therefore, our view is very clear to those who are in public life. Those who are in public life must learn to accept criticism. Fun, pun, joke is a part of democratic life. But my problem is, I see in the American campaign this becoming a quiet casualty. Okay? That is also important.
Excellent, sir. But I think as law minister, perhaps there is also an issue around capacity building at the three.
Let me lift it on a larger level, because you invoked my minister job as a law minister. Today, terrorism is becoming a very important issue. Okay. Lots of ISIS platforms are abusing ICT in the most vigorous manner, in the most technically savvy manner. What we do? Because when you talk of rights, those who are creating mayhem, killing people with impunity in the name of terrorism, are also abusing ICT. That is a very sensitive issue where some fine balance is needed. Right to life, national security is equally important. That's how I see it.
Please join me in applauding the minister for his remarks and his engagement with us. And thank you, Mr. Minister. Let me invite the three panelists for a 40-minute conversation that we have left. Mr. Vijay Shekhar Sharma, Mr. Harin Fernando, the Minister from Sri Lanka.
And I hope Sunil and Vijay will respond to some of the concerns they have articulated.
I will ask them different questions and reach different conclusions, but I'll get there. Thank you, Mr.
Thank you.
So we'll start where the previous conversation left, and let me turn to Mr. Sunil Mittal. As most of you would know, he's what I would call the telecom czar, the communication czar of this country, also someone whose work has led to India being able to launch something called Digital India. He and his peers in the Indian telecom and IT sector, in the digital sector, have created a framework where we can now be ambitious with what we want to do. So, sir, let me ask you what the lady, in a sense, asked the minister. What can the private sector do to ensure affordable access to many who still lack it? So we have big numbers, but we also have that 25-30% in terms of telecommunication who are struggling with access, and of course, more than half of the Indian population still miles away from internet.
Well, I think the large part of the job that remains to be done is not really on affordability anymore. To my mind, the South Asian story is one of affordability, not just India, but I would say, hasten to add, Sri Lanka, Bangladesh in particular, and many other parts of this region can be very proud that they have been able to bring the best technologies, the latest cutting-edge technologies, at the most affordable tariffs. I mean, it's almost unthinkable in any other part of the world that you can get to these tariff levels. The problem is we need to roll out and get to that, what was mentioned, to the last women and last man in the most furthest corner and the furthest forest and the furthest hills and ranges of Himalayas as fast as possible. Regretfully, some will still be left out because whatever we may do, we'll never be able to reach the last 5, 7, 8%. And that is the case even with the most affluent parts of the world. I work closely as an investor and on the board of a company which has just been launched called OneWeb. That company is going to put up 900 satellites on the lower orbit in the next 3 or 4 years. And the purpose of that is to get to everybody in the world, because the only way to get to that last mile is by way of satellite. No fiber, no radio communications, no terrestrial network can ever reach those points. And surprisingly, the affluent countries are jumping onto OneWeb faster than Africa or India or Bangladesh, because UK, for example, is wanting to give 25 million as grant to ensure that parts of Northern England, Scotland, and Wales can be covered. And similarly, US and many other places, in particular Canada and Australia, have very large swaths of territory which are not covered through any telecommunication facilities. So we're getting there. I think the spectrum was one of the biggest issues that has been resolved to a very large degree. Lots of spectrum, as you are all aware, has been put up on the table. Most have been picked up. More will be picked up going forward. I think the rollout is now accelerating. My own view is currently we are covering about 93% of India's population on a mobile network that needs to be now converted into a broadband network, mm-hmm. which is currently only covering about 22%, 23%, 24% of the people. But the good news is with the lowering down of prices of smartphones, I think things are really accelerating. And I'm sure Vijay is seeing the graphs really rise very rapidly in terms of smartphone usage and people getting onto the broadband bandwagon.
So I want to turn your attention to two regions that you're familiar with. The first, of course, is Africa, where you are a major player. And of course, you can probably also pick on some of the experiences from there, which have allowed integration take place across borders. But also, you run affordable programs around data. And I think it's no one's case that telecommunication is expensive in India, but I think broadband is something that's still an hurdle that requires some solutions. So how would you, one, look at integration across borders, and second, how would you bring the cost of data down?
I think integration across borders is almost a given in a telecom network. You have no choice but to integrate. And thankfully, within South Asia, I think India has been taking the lead. Very recently, we have set up a connectivity exchange in Agartala, which connects us and Bangladesh. That has allowed us to get to some submarine cables outside the Bangladesh. And there are two landlocked nations, as you know, Nepal and Bhutan, who have no way accessing the oceans. And India is providing a lot of connectivity to them. So I think this region is fairly well connected interstate between them. And there are now lots of submarine cables going out of India. I think Sri Lanka has also probably got one now going to Singapore. And so this region is now, from a 10, 15 years back point of view, where it was having serious connectivity issues and relying in many parts by way of satellites, is now having robust subsea cables. So I think connectivity is pretty good now. On to your second part, as what can be done to further lower the data pricing, I think last 2 weeks itself you've seen a massive reduction of data pricing. What is important is, and what sort of has to flow together, is the rapid rise of usage as you lower the data. Because in the end, you need to pick up a particular amount of money from each customer to justify your serious investments in spectrum, networks, and all that needs to go in. I mean, you must know that Airtel, being the most financially sustainable company in India, makes an ROC of 9%. It's a single digit, which is very close to putting the money in the bank.
Very close.
And we run a very complicated business. So it's not that it's lower, you know, the effort is much less than putting money in the bank. But it needs to get to a much sharper level where the balance comes through. So everybody's hoping that as you lower the tariffs on data now, the uptake will go up. The good news is we are seeing in certain packages and pockets that the data usage, which are struggling around 1 GB a month, may actually jump and settle to 3 or 4 GB a month.
That's a promising, trend. Mr. Minister, Mr. Harin Fernando, of course, is driving the Digital Sri Lanka initiative, and I'm going to ask you to speak about that briefly. But also, how important is it to integrate this region as one digital market?
Well, I would first and foremost think that all what the Minister Prasad said, we at Sri Lanka have been looking to India as a big brother always, and we always want to implement what India did. But when it comes to the other, Sri Lanka is just at the brink of doing the same thing, but in a very bigger version of it. Technically, I think we have trying to implement what Estonia and Sweden did. But what amazed me was India is quite technically more savvy than Sri Lanka, I would say. But the other software was done by a Sri Lankan company.
That's right.
So it gave me a bit of a thrill just to see Virtusa, being a Sri Lankan company, doing the other software. So also, when you look at it, it is always good to work with India because it's a huge market. There's a lot to learn from India. I mean, Airtel being in Sri Lanka, it also gives us a major advantage and a benefit. Just to elaborate on one fact about connectivity, digitization is nothing without connectivity. So you need to first make sure that the connectivity is right. Even when Minister was saying it's about 270 million people that is connected, that's about 40% or 35% in India who are still connected, which is similarly in Sri Lanka, we sitting with 20 million population. We are about 30% who are still connected on digital devices. So we're still not connected if you really look at it, however digital we are going to get. And we still have the risk of explaining to our population what digital is. How many of our population knows what digital is? This is the first barrier that I had to face when last year our government was formed and I was given the Ministry of Digital Infrastructure together with Telecommunication. So I tried to find, because I come from a very rural constituency in Sri Lanka, which is one of the poorest. And when I became the digital minister, my people were very unhappy because they didn't know what digital was. So I tried to explain to them what digital could do to them. So I went to the dictionary, because digital is numbers, but numbers wouldn't matter to them. So I said, digital is what life brings to you, to your fingertips. And if it's digital banking, or if it's anything in digital e-governance, everything brings it to your fingertips. In 10 years or 5 years, our village agriculture will be on their fingertips, checking your weather, going on to AccuWeather check and thinking what time it's going to rain. They'll know at what time to go into your paddy. So it's simple as that. So you need to simplify to get it out in their heads, to get them to be included. So I think the integration of how India works, how all of this works, is something that we need to plan and get the expertise and the knowledge in here. Sri Lanka right now, I think, is sitting in a very pretty place. I think 2070 is we're going to revolutionize, and there are a lot of agreements that PM Modi and our Prime Minister is just getting ahead. And I'm very happy our Prime Minister is very savvy with IT, so it looks very good.
Well, how do you see the KPO sector picking up in Sri Lanka? It has such a strong cadre of accountants and other...
Yes. So in Sri Lanka, we have lots of accountants and a lot of... I think after UK, we have the most amount of CIMA-qualified accountants in Sri Lanka and legal people. So what we're really concentrating is not on BPOs, but on KPOs. So we have already appointed two ambassadors for India specifically, just to ask Indian companies to come. Because as I said again, connectivity is key. Sri Lanka is only 65,000 square kilometers, and out of that, 32,000 is already fiber optic cables have been laid. And we have two submarine cables in Sri Lanka, so it gives us 6 times the broadband speed. Plus, we are doing the Google balloon. So that's an innovation that we have tried. That's lots of people have criticism, but I love that innovation, because if it works, we'll be the first country to have the entire country covered on 4G LTE technology. So that will put us on the map. And in November, we're doing the piloting. Already people call me the balloon Harin, because if one balloon fell down. So already I've become a joke in Sri Lanka. But innovation, innovation is something that you really need to give an opportunity. If it works, it's a gamble, but if it works, you are going to cut so much of CapEx cost on most of the companies. Like Airtel, we have 5 companies, which is too much in Sri Lanka, telecom providers. We have 2 Malaysian companies, Indian, Emirati company. So I think it's too big. We are trying to scale it down to about 2 or 3 player market. We want to merge and want to bring it smaller, so better service could be offered. So we're looking at all these models, but if the Google balloon works, we can cut most of the company's CapEx costs and get value addition instead, and give more content to be provided with all the questions that was asked about ladies, the inclusion. And what we also believe is we're trying to get everybody included by a thing called the National Digital Facilitation Centers around Sri Lanka. So they will know how to use a device, what to be done. We also have a thing called a smart social circle that we have already established. We have 14,000 Grama Nildari divisions, which is like the lowest level of community-based centers. We having the community leaders being taught about digital devices already, how to use it, what to do, how do you access. So that way, we will get everybody included of how they will be using this in the next 3 to 4 years. And plus, we're starting in schools, so we're giving tablets for next year, starting with grade 9 students. We have procured, because we only have 3 million students in Sri Lanka overall. Out of that, we're giving 500,000 students tablets with a keypad, with a 10-inch keypad as well, 10-inch screen with a keypad, and we want to start coding with every student at grade 9 level. So we want to build that up.
But before I turn to Vijay, sir, can I come back to you and ask you, do you find a reluctance in India to experiment with some of these new technologies and new schemes? You know, you have a zero rating working in Africa, but in India you saw this regulatory pushback. We are hesitant about lower Earth orbit satellites. How do you see this policy space expanding?
Well, I think the march of technology never stops, and you will eventually have to adopt all technologies, whether it's the Google balloon, or its OneWeb satellites, or what Elon Musk is trying to do on his satellite project, or the Facebook drone that they are planning, the plane, airplane, the solar plane that they're planning. So all this will eventually get sorted out. If you look at the underlying theme of all this is to cover those unconnected. So it's really all of them are that last billion. We call it in our industry the last 1 billion. We need to connect those people wherever they are. And there's got to be a way out. I am less enthusiastic about the balloon than about satellites, because you have to control your emitting positions, and it's very hard to do it in a balloon. And they float all the places. It may work for some benefit of some of the farmers, some areas and all that, but it'll not be that focused and directed. But I think all these need to be welcomed, because at least trials are going on for something that has not been conquered and overcome for the last 6 or 7 decades.
Clearly, you believe in the low Earth orbit satellites. You've invested there. Vijay, you are probably running what we call the most exciting part of the digital economy, the unicorns, the new ways of transacting, engaging, communicating, and building value. Does India have that culture to adopt this and race with this? I think because there is a technology issue, but there is also an adoption issue.
Yeah, I think any technology has two sides of stakeholders. One is consumer, one is more or less a business or a merchant or a government or something else which you are interacting with. Let me say, consumers are very enthusiastic about it, because the classic problem of India or asset of India being the lot of young people, they are ready for the change more comfortably than the traditional ones. And youngs can be persuaded to do something newer in a newer way than normally older person would take time to get accepted. So consumer side is sorted. Now, merchant side, in our business, there was a lot of challenge and myth in early days that if you take digital payments, somebody's income will get disclosed, if you will, or more known, so the tax brackets will come and the opportunity of tax men would knocking at your door would come and you would never be tracked and whatnot. And we found it was myth, actually, because people have found, we're finding that people are reaching out to us that I do not have Paytm accepted at my place versus we thought that there would be persuasion of a time. Today, we are signing up 5,000 merchants a day who get onboarded with a sticker and a physical POS. So effectively, this year end, we would cross 1.5 million merchants. And then in next 3 years, our target is 10 million physical places where you can pay using Paytm, which is exactly when you said acceptance, I'm finding it the other way around, that there is a zeal towards it. And maybe it is a novelty zeal, maybe it is a, can I grow a business deal, or maybe it is a, I sound more young, youth-centric company available to in the way they speak language zeal, but it is there. It is very much there.
And do you see a difference between, say, rural India and peri-urban and urban centers? So when you say young people, is it a universal description across India, or do you see that?
It surprisingly is significantly deep down in tier 2, tier 3 cities. A young person of a city that I come from, my class 12th was in a town where the population would not be more than 2,500 people. So yes, that city is equal, or that town is equally enthusiastic as much the city is. City guys have more choices, so they sort of have more choice of selection of one over other and decision making, while the people there, if they get to know, they just want to quickly get onto it. The very reason that we find ourselves in an exciting sweet spot is because those are the people who are driving it and becoming a brand ambassador there.
So you see an uptake even in smaller towns and villages?
Actually, it is higher, by the way. Top 15 city will constitute 45 to 50% number, and then beyond that it is four. We were doing this number 590 pin codes, Delhi being identified as one in this, by the way, while the pin codes are Delhi are many, are the number of pin codes where merchants were accepting like a 3 month active cohort, which was totally funny. I wouldn't have thought that we would go more than 500 cities in this country.
You know, I want to pose a question to all three of you, which I asked the minister. Is this sector going to create jobs? Is this going to transform jobs, or is it going to destroy jobs?
I'm going to put it, I like the question, by the way, and let's look at what is happening. India has a consumption which is being served by fewer people, larger businesses, those who have wherewithal and are nearby in that vicinity, if not larger businesses. Technology is creating an opportunity to a person who is not having that customer in front of them. So in my theory, first it will create job in a sector where there are not enough supplies because there is a consumption and it is not efficiently being offered. So it is creating opportunity for this villager who is producing something to be sold to the person who is far away, or this villager to have formal financial inclusion and services which otherwise weren't available, so the person can increase the consumption or selling and the ability
of loans.
So the small
producers are coming into business.
Or small producers or people who did not have financial services are getting opportunity to get loan or and so on and so forth. So basically it is increasing and then which flows down, so you have a bigger shop and more people to manage and more people to produce. So it is creating jobs. It'll create job for the underserved and served environment, while in a massively overserved environment. Let me take a situation of an airline industry, if you will. Check-in counters won't be needed. That effectively means lesser points are required at that point. But that is where exactly you need efficiency the technology has to drive. So it'll take jobs at a very small sector and a very small places where the efficiency is a valuable reason for that industry to sustain and survive. And it'll create a job in a more holistic manner at the places where they need it to be created.
So bottom of the pyramid will see job creation.
And the top of the pyramid will get more efficiency.
Great.
I see it in a very a different side of it as well, on a political angle. When I heard the panel discussion yesterday, a garment's aim should be to have at least an 8% growth if you were to sustain this technology. And the fourth industrial revolution in a political sense should be a knowledge-based economy. And to do that, if technical stuff has to improve, we need to build them up there. And the school structure, how you have the education system moving up, this will create more jobs. We see in our country children falling out of school and just doing mere jobs. In India, for example, in Sri Lanka, you fall out of school, you get into a three-wheeler, or you become a three-wheeler driver, or just go into a company. Just be your life until you finish your life. You're just in labor. But that's not what you want to see to our countries. They need to grow. So if that's the sense that you want to see your country moving up to, that's where the job creation will be. There'll be a knowledge-based economy built in that country. So for that, all these technical things would give them that job, they would give them the market, that could be, that's a dream that you can actually achieve. So I see from the younger generation of the schools, you give them that right education. In Sri Lanka, we're doing it now. We had this system where we have an ordinary level exam. If you fail, you fail out of school and you drop out. And we clearly saw that for all of us is where you, at 16 years, you do this exam. And 600,000 students normally for a year sit. And advanced level only 200,000 students sit. So 400,000 per year was falling out of school. And they didn't have jobs. So now we take a policy decision. All the 600,000 students will be moved on for 13 years of compulsory education. If they don't do well, they will go into vocational training. They'll get some sort of education in their systems. So I think, you know, when you get a knowledge-based economy, it's very easy. And I think IT is a key sector. Some students may not be bright in maths or science or whatever, but you give them a device, they do wonders. And that's something that we have really figured out with younger children and the younger generation. And I mean, see for our own kids, you give them a device, they're very
good. So that's an interesting take. So bottom of the pyramid job creation, knowledge job creation. So Mr. Rajan Mittal had spoken many years ago, I think 4 or 5 years ago at a conference, and I remember him telling us that roughly 100 million Indians could not read or write, but were keypad literate. They could play with those 12 keys on an old phone and do certain activities. And you had, in a sense, enabled them past their level of literacy. Very soon, in a couple of years, you will have more people connected broadband than those who would have cleared secondary school. So what is the kind of the job technology nexus that you see emerging in a place like India?
Well, you know, there are, I would say, competing forces at the moment. And they are very, very strong competing forces. And from my standpoint, I see technology all around me. I talk to a lot of people. As the chairman of ICC now, I sit on a global business body. I see a lot of stress in the job area. In fact, the current growth, whatever little is happening, as you know, both WTO and IMF have set the growth rates lower for this year. And the US will eventually probably drop down from below 2%, and the worldwide average will be at 3%, just because emerging markets are still growing. This growth is missing one part. It is a low growth, but it's a jobless growth. That's a serious concern for all the politicians, whether it's in Sri Lanka or it's in India. And the other competing force that is anti-globalization and anti-immigration. These are two very, very strong forces at play at the moment. And that's a worry for countries like India, because what's our capital? Our capital, above all, everything else, is our people. And if we don't have the access of these people to take jobs anywhere in the world, which was the case, and the whole premise of globalization and to which India signed in and enthusiastically followed, opening up of FDI, opening up each sector, and suddenly you're saying when India needs to get into the world economy or their spaces, there seems to be restrictions coming in. So first of all, I was glad that the Indian government has taken upon itself to introduce the trade facilitation for services in WTO. I think in the next week or 2 weeks, they'll present that. There'll be tremendous amount of resistance against that, but India needs to push it through. I personally am working with the WTO Director General on that. There is a section which will welcome it. There's a very large, forceful section which is going to oppose it. So that's one part. So India has to worry about our knowledge workers, yours and mine, to be blocked from getting global jobs onshore in those countries. Now, there will be a lot of opportunities offshoring in which you can do things from here. But even there, when you hear Clinton or Trump, both are saying we want to bring back jobs into the U.S. So that's a massive competing force that is going on, and we need to worry about that. Secondly, you pick up artificial intelligence, which is now becoming real. It's just no more in the future. It's here and now. Add AR, VR, augmented reality and virtual reality. You put robotics with that, and everything sits in the cloud. You are looking at massive disruption in many, many areas of jobs. We just spoke about airline counters. I can go and reel out 20 others, whether it's the broking floors of the banks, which actually employs most of the people, analysts, brokers. You will not need anybody. Just one or two bots sitting there will do everything that is required to be done. You go into law firms, the maximum amount of employment is in the research assistants or people who are coming out of law school to assist the senior counsels. We saw the Watson 4 months back doing a case for the senior counsel. It was all produced by Watson, the computer. No human intervention. It was significantly more sophisticated than anybody could have produced, because it can pick up every and anything in the world, refer to those case laws, and produce the best document. There were three surgeons put on test against a robotic arm to do a pig gallbladder surgery. It was clearly established that the robotic arm did a much superior job than the three best surgeons. So you are looking at displacement of many, many jobs. You talk about autonomous cars. Tens of millions of drivers are going to come out of it. As politicians, people need to start worrying about how to find the next level of jobs, higher or lower, because you don't want disruption in the society. We should not, while celebrating massive march of technology, forget that there are forces at work which will create difficulties.
And to underscore your point, sir, I read a news report recently which suggests that textile, which was the first industry to be sent to the global south, is now going back home because of robotics and artificial intelligence. And you have machines producing garments. And I think that's the worry part. I'm going to now open it up for questions, but I do want to leave one thought with each of you, and maybe in the closing remarks you can address it. Gender and technology. Gender and digital economy. How do we make it gender aware? But I'm opening it up for questions. You can raise your arms. Yeah, please. And please, sir. Identify yourself and pose a question either to one or to generally to the entire panel.
Sir, I'm Parminder. I'm from Punjab. So my question is to Mr. Mittal. So you have said that so the artificial intelligence and robotics, it's going to rule the world. And in India, we have so much of illiterate population, and possibly government might not be able to make so much of India literate. And specifically in these fields, artificial intelligence and robotics, which is just the emerging field. So how do you think that private sector can play a role in, making India more literate and knowledgeable, particularly in the context of these two fields, which you alluded to?
Well, I personally would like to point you towards the digital mission that the Prime Minister has outlined. It's a very, very powerful pillar of his economic agenda. And around that, if you look at the BharatNet, which is rolling out of fiber, which was earlier called NOFN, rolling out fiber across the entire country, connecting every village level of governance onto that fiber. More mobile broadband, more broadband networks coming out, smartphones rates getting down. You're going to see a lot of people who, I would say, even a few years back could not have been able to get onto the digital wave, will get onto it. So I'm very confident that the Indians, by and large, given that the user interfaces are very friendly, people can pick up through sound and touch things that they could not earlier do, will make a lot of young Indians very, very digitally literate. That's a given. Now, will they be able to now also get onto robotics and artificial intelligence and use more of the leading edge technologies? My confidence is high. Indians have generally been very, very good with adoption of technology. I mean, I'm stunned when I see some of the very old people in villages, how well they can use the phones as compared to what was there 5 or 7 years back. So I remain confident. The government is aware. The government is wanting to push the digital agenda forward. The digital trade part that Vijay is leading in one big part is also pushing that agenda, because people will like to buy online, people will like to transact online, people will like to deal with the government online. So I remain optimistic. I think we have to keep pushing hard. One good news is India is a continent of consumers. We are in ourselves a very, very large market. And I remain confident that we'll be able to fulfill the aspirations of many, many millions of our people.
Can we have the mic here, please? A gentleman here. There are two of them, in fact. What we'll do is we'll take these three questions together, and then we'll go to the final round of comments from the panelists. So please.
Hi, my name is Amrit, and I work for Mint newspaper. We've talked about the future of technology, IT, etc. The primary point, and which is perhaps most important, Mr. Mittal, is the quality of service that we get. With the current round of spectrum auctions getting over yesterday, how do you see that panning out in the future? I mean, I want an answer not on behalf of the not on behalf of Airtel, but on behalf of the industry.
Can we take all three of them? Yeah, because then we'll go to the closing. Yeah, please.
Hi, I'm Kitvina. I'm a global shaper from Colombo. In a previous session, we spoke about India being the leader of the second world when it came to technological entrepreneurship. In the same vein, my question is, what can other countries do, for example, Sri Lanka do, to encourage or incentivize Indian entrepreneurship or investment in the technological field come into their countries? What have you found to be barriers in entering these markets?
And Amitabh.
I'm also a global shaver and I work for Microsoft. So my question is to both the businessmen sitting here. So recently Microsoft and Google, Facebook and I believe IBM partnered on AI research. So do you see some sort of collaboration in your industries respectively? And I just want to also congratulate the minister of saying that India and Sri Lanka have a lot to learn from each other, e-commerce and other fields.
Great. So I will add my last.
Vijay can take the second.
Yeah. So, but I will like all of you to address my question, which is: are we seeing two things happening? One, women benefiting from technology, and two, women leading the digital economy. So, can we next year see women here in this panel? I think that's the challenge for us. So, that's my question to this panel. But go ahead. Or you want to start, sir? Why don't you start?
I can take the first question on behalf of the mobile industry. You know, the ingredient that drives high-quality networks is really nothing but spectrum. And you know the Indian spectrum position has been woefully inadequate compared to any other part of the world. We have come from that problem in a dramatically good way, in a very fast manner. I think government has been able to harmonize a lot of spectrum. A lot of spectrum was put onto the table. Parts and segments of those spectrum are extremely expensive. And I think missing out on the 700 megahertz, which is truly a very high quality spectrum, which in fact Sri Lanka has not got it from the broadcasters as yet, we have been able to get it, should have been put to good use. Three or four good solid networks around 700 would have taken care of a lot of rural broadband networks, and this is a missed opportunity. I hope the government will look into this and correct that particular part. But leave that aside, there is still a lot of other spectrum that has been made available. I personally believe that you will see tremendous amount of upliftment of broadband speeds. My own company has picked up a second carrier in most of the key places that not only just doubles your spectrum speeds, the broadband speeds, but gives you probably 5 or 6x of speeds coming through. So in the coming months, you'll start seeing massive improvements across the country, not just by my company, but all the industry players who have actively participated. India is finally getting out of fractured spectrum. It was earlier very small, and then it was fractured amongst 12 players. We are getting down to 4 players now, and I think that would mean that the spectrum will not be an issue. And industry is investing enough, more towers are coming up. The other issue was radiation scare. I am quite pleased that Ravi Shankar Prasad ji himself and the current minister have been now clearly giving comfort to the society that India is actually at a much more tighter norms than anywhere else in the world. We are 1/10 of Europe and US, and people are getting more comfortable. You can put out more sites. So I would say things are better already. But in the last 5 or 6 months, things are significantly better, but they will keep on getting better. Vijay?
Yeah. About the investment in Sri Lanka first. So India has a great market, and like all of us want to learn first what is happening in this country, and this is the, let's say, the testing or the scaling space. And then like Airtel landed in Sri Lanka, I think the opportunity for Indian companies comes after they have sort of built a sustainable moat in India. Before that, it is very flimsy to go there. And maybe some technology services which are built using apps which are totally ported just because the app store exists can go there, but that doesn't technically mean that you've gone there and invested something especially. So I'd say that technology companies are yet in early days of sustenance for themselves, and once they get standing on their feet stronger, then they will logically go there. On AI front, like you shared, one of the things that I'm a little disappointed about India is that we've been traditionally known as producer for the world in technology, IT services, classically. I was figuring out that TCS has a great amount of software built on AI, but except that it is a practice, they gave it to the customers that, look, we can build something on AI. While as far as the industry is concerned, companies are concerned, are they internally in sync on building something, collaboration? I think it's a classic country where surviving is called thriving. We are still there. I mean, look at the telecom. We're talking about reaching out places, and we are talking about consumers getting the access and then growing beyond that. And ROC 9%, hearing that, I think this is a classic that when Bharti gives that return, then talk about what others are doing. So do we have an opportunity to thrive beyond survive? I think that is still far away. So these are good opportunities to talk about. But before that, we want bread and butter taken care for long first.
And women in the new economy.
Women in the new economy is inevitability, because I think India is one of those rare countries where IT services have been the biggest. I mean, I learned it a while back from our minister that IT services have been the place where. So if we were talking about this space, it is all about, I think, aspirational, which women are now completely forward. Indian government has even put mandates in boardrooms and then at places. So I'm far more hopeful that there is more women going to come proactively and suggested from the ecosystem than earlier if it was remaining so.
Great. Final word to you, Minister.
Well, I would just also say a word about the women. I think Sri Lanka faces a huge challenge because we're very underrepresented even in our political scenario when it comes to women. Unlike India, we have only 13% of women representing the parliament as well. So I think we're taking key initiatives on that. And last week, we had UN doing a special program with us on digitization with women. So I think we're very keen and we're looking into it. And we have got some content and we're getting a lot of women involved. I hope to see that by next year we'll do something.
One finger intervention, but the producers are telling me I have 30 seconds.
So. All right, then. So this is actually for Mr. Mittal because he's just brought out just the correct thing, which is globally being talked that how technology is going to eat the primary jobs on the top quadrant. So what, as a business person, as a capitalist who says that let the best man survive, says to the society and politician and governments that in such scenarios when technology is taking the top job, what is left there, reskilling being not necessarily the scalable solution, if you will, and then still what kind of jobs are going to be there, really?
Well, we need to fight on the global stage. We need to have open access, open visas. Immigration should not be a blocking issue against India. And of course, India needs to find a lot more jobs within the country. The good news is we are growing at 7-8%. That will continue to create a lot of jobs for the next several years.
Excellent. So those were the final words for this panel. Join me in applauding the panelists for their interventions and engagement. And thank you all for joining us. Let me also thank the online viewers for being with us this afternoon. Thank you very much, sir.